We've been looking in Matthew chapter 13 as Jesus has been teaching in parables and explaining a couple of them, not all of them, but we've tried to explain them all. And the first parable, just as a way of quick review, the parable of the sower, where our Lord said that the word of God is going to have a variety of response depending on the heart of the person who hears it. And he gave four examples. Really only one was good and lasting and fruit-bearing. But even though that was the case, just one out of four, nonetheless, the kingdom would start so small and grow to be big one day. In fact, it would grow to be so big that Satan would infect the kingdom with his servants, some of whom would be indistinguishable from God's servants, at least for a time. But there would be a coming judgment, and God is going to set everything right. And that was the wheat and the tares parable that not only was told, but also explained by Jesus. And that's pretty much where we closed last Sunday. Now we have three more to go concerning the kingdom. Starting with verse 44, we read, again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid, and for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. So here we have another pairing up, two short parables back to back, both teaching basically the same idea, and that idea is pretty clear, that the kingdom of heaven is valuable, worth pursuing, securing to oneself. That's the key. Now, in terms of the cultural understanding of what's going on, we probably don't have to elaborate in too much detail. We can all relate to the idea of, you know, burying treasure in the backyard, right? Maybe a little less common these days than it was in ancient days, but it was quite common in the past. I mean, if you had your life savings in some gold or silver coins, you didn't just leave them around the house to get stolen. You might find a special spot on the property and bury them, and of course you hope you don't die and no one knows where they are, right? But that was something that was common. Now, the Jewish law in these days had an interesting idea, sort of a finder's keeper's mentality. As long as what you found was something light enough and small enough that you could lift it. So if you found something on the ground, it potentially was yours, which implies that maybe this treasure was quite dramatic and something that this guy could not just lift for himself. And since it's on the land, well, land, of course, had to be sold in a transfer with a deed, that sort of thing. And so this guy says, well, I'm going to buy the land, and of course I get everything that's on the land when I do. And so that's what he did, even though the land would certainly cost him a lot of money. The treasure was worth it. And then the second example, again, pretty simple. We have a merchant, notice described as a merchant, a businessman, who is in the business of buying and selling pearls. And he discovers this pearl that is so valuable and incredible that he wants that for himself. And I've encountered people like that who are in the, they make money buying and selling, whether it may be stamps or coins or baseball cards or, you know, whatever, little collectible type things. And as they do that, they don't really have their heart attached to these things because it's where they're at. But then they find something really rare. They have the opportunity to secure that. And not only do they get it, but they make sure that, you know, that one doesn't go for sale. That goes in our private collection. We're going to hold on to that one. So again, both illustrations fairly simple to understand, and the emphasis is on the value. Now, what is interesting, though, in the two that Jesus chooses here, you notice one speaks to an accidental discovery, the guy who finds the treasure in the field,
And the other is a deliberate discovery. Now, maybe he didn't know he was going to get this great pearl, but that's his job. He was buying and selling pearls. So one deliberate, one accidental. And I find that fascinating because when it comes to people's testimonies and you talk around and you find out, well, tell me how you came to know Jesus Christ or whatever, that's what you typically see. You see on the one hand, those who say, man, I woke up one morning, the last thing on my mind was God. And before the day ended, I was born again. You know, I met this guy, and they go on with their testimony, and that happens, doesn't it? But then there's also those who are like, well, you know, for months I was really seeking, you know, after truth and some sort of higher power and metaphysical reality. I was just going to go wherever the search went. Jesus said, if you seek, you will find him. I mean, if you're seeking with a sincere heart, I want to know the truth. Wherever it leads me, it'll lead you to Jesus. But Jesus also said that he's out seeking and saving the lost, which also speaks to the accidental aspect. So you have that balance there. Both are true. Now, we don't want to go too crazy with the parables. Again, parables are teaching a basic truth, and we just discussed that. Jesus clearly is not saying that salvation can be bought. You know, sell everything you have and buy the kingdom. That is not a proper conclusion to draw. That would go against the entire teaching of Scripture. We know that. But he is speaking about the tremendous value and the priority and how anything else in comparison is not even to be considered. Whatever it takes, secure the kingdom. It's that valuable. Now, we come to this seventh and final parable here, verse 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but threw the bad away. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come forth, separate the wicked from among the just, and cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. This one, very similar to the wheat and the tares that we looked at last Sunday, especially the fact that Jesus gives the interpretation of the parable, and the interpretation is almost identical in terms of this dragnet and the fish. Now, we live in a time that usually when you're fishing for something specific. I mean, whether you're using rod and reel or whatever, but though I'm no expert, I don't think that we can just take a net and start dragging it through the ocean and scoop up anything we want, right? I mean, there's some laws against that sort of stuff. Dolphins get caught in the net and, you know, it's a big deal. But in Jesus' day, and especially when it comes to the Sea of Galilee, that's how they fished. You just throw a big old net out there and scoop up everything you can. Most of the fish that were in the Sea of Galilee were, according to the law of Moses, edible, so they could be sold, but there would be a few things that you would scoop up that you would not want to eat and would be not allowed to eat, and I'm sure there were also little small fish or whatever that you wouldn't be able to sell, and so there would be that separation. That's what fishermen did. Reminds me of the Deadliest Catch when they get the crab, right? I mean, they go and they bring the big crate up there, the pot up there, and what do? They go to the sorting tail and they're just like, because some of the crab they can't legally sell and market, so they just throw it back in the ocean. So Jesus is using an illustration here with the net, and again, using a very similar explanation as he did with the wheat and the tares to explain that there is a coming judgment. A judgment is coming, and people are going to be separated into two groups, not three or four, two. When it comes to the fish, the good fish and the bad fish, however the bad is, an unmarketable fish. And then, of course, there was the wheat and the tares, the good and the bad there. Now, in both cases, whether it be the wheat or the good fish, we see the description of being righteous or just. I know it's different English words, but they're the same Greek word, basically. So righteous is used in verse 43. And then just is used in verse 49. To be righteous, to be justified. That's the group you want to be in. Now, Jesus has not elaborated on this reality yet, but we know the totality of the teaching of Scripture is simple on this point. None of us
are righteous. No, not one. In fact, all the righteous works that we try to do, they're like filthy rags in God's sight. None of us do good, not by God's standard. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And yet there are righteous people, justified people. And I hope you're one of them. How do we get justified, righteous, declared that way by God? By grace through faith in Jesus Christ. He is the righteous one. He knew no sin, he committed no sin, he had no sin nature, and yet he died on the cross for your sins and mine. And he rose from the dead, conquered the grave. He's alive today to receive all who would come to him, seeking that forgiveness, seeking that mercy and grace that only he can offer. And in exchange for this wonderful gift, he imputes his perfect righteousness to us. We're declared righteous. We're in the good camp here of the fish. In contrast, the wheat and the tares describe the tares as those who practice lawlessness. There up in verse 41, and then in the fish illustration we just read, verse 49, they are described as the wicked. Separate the wicked from the just. Again, we're all wicked, but we can be declared justified by faith. And notice that Jesus is very clear. In this coming judgment, the wicked are going to be sent to hell. Now people say, now wait a minute, you know, these are symbolic illustrations here. Don't take that fire stuff too literally and all that. Well, that's what they did. You know, they burned the tares in those days, that darnel stuff you talked about last week. That's true. I don't know, though, that they necessarily burned the bad fish. But even if they did, I mean, I'm no expert in that area, but I really doubt that the fish were wailing and gnashing their teeth. And I guarantee you the tares weren't wailing and gnashing any teeth. And so for Jesus to say at this judgment there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth, he is speaking about the judgment of hell. Again, this bothers people because it becomes this issue of, well, this loving, gracious God of mercy and faith that you're talking about, and what's he doing creating hell in the first place? Well, the Bible has those answers. Hell was created for the devil, for the angels that joined the devil in the rebellion against God. Hell was not created for human beings. But you see, God created us for free. Yes, we have a sin nature, but we are moral creatures. We can make choices, can't we? We can choose to say nice things or hurtful things. We can choose to hug or choose to punch someone in the face. I mean, we can do all sorts of things as we choose, and there are consequences for those choices. One of those gotcha questions people like to throw at God is, you know, well, God can do everything, right? Well, can he make a square circle? And it's a ludicrous sort of question because it's just a confusing of the categories, of the definitions. You can't have a square circle, obviously. So it's a foolish question. Well, in like manner, if we think about it, you can't have a free creature without responsibility and consequences. He can't just make us all a bunch of puppets, a bunch of robots when it comes to our eternal destinies, but leave us free the rest of the time to go have some fun out here, you know? No. There are consequences. And we can choose to humble ourselves before the Lord, the creator of the universe, and receive the free gift that Jesus offers, be born again, forgiven of all of our sins, and know that we have eternal life in God's glorious presence forever. But God's not going to force the person who wants nothing to do with this Jesus guy to be with Jesus forever, right? You make your choice. Choose wisely. And so, there is a judgment coming. Now, we're still got one more parable to go, though it's not really a parable about the kingdom, is it? As you notice, verse 51,
Jesus said to them, now here the them is the disciples. Remember, the parables go out to the multitudes. They're scratching their heads and wondering what's going on. And Jesus is making sure the disciples understand. That's why he's interpreting some of them. So he says to them, the disciples, have you understood all these things? And they said to him, yes, Lord. Then he said to them, therefore every scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure things new and old. Now that's fascinating. New and old. First of all, remember, scribe is not a dirty word. I mean, we get used to seeing the scribes show up with the Pharisees and the Gospels. They're always causing Jesus problems, and we might think, oh, no, here come the scribes. But a scribe in those days is someone who knows God's word, is a student of God's word, seeking to understand God's word, seeking to share God's word with others. In those days, actually literally writing it down and writing the understandings and so forth. And so the scribes butted head with Jesus a lot, but what I'm saying is the job itself is a very noble one if done properly and with a heart towards God. And so he's saying, you know, if you're instructed concerning the kingdom, because they said, yeah, we understand, then it's like you have this stewardship over this treasure. You know, God's word, his understanding, and you bring that forth. And then he says, things new and old. Now that's an interesting twist as well. Jesus certainly taught some new things. Remember the new wine has to go into new wineskins and that sort of thing? But it wasn't so much that it was new in the sense of just created out of thin air. Whoa, we've never heard anything like that. What he was doing, even though it was new to the audience, he was really going back to the proper understanding of God's word, wasn't he? He was seeking to get the traditions out of their minds and take them back to the scriptures. So it may have seemed new, but it really wasn't. And of course, again, he's not radically changing anything. It just amazes me when people talk, I don't like that God of the Old Testament. You know, he's smiting people and all that. I like the God of the New Testament. I like Jesus and all that. But there's no difference between the God of the Old Testament and the God of the New Testament. God does not change between the Testaments. And if we look at church history today, we see what Jesus is talking about here in verse 52 show itself, illustrated in various ways. On the one hand, there are certain truths about God, who Jesus is. And these things are not only non-negotiable, but they are established and they have been established for centuries. Someone comes up to you and says, you know, I got a new take on Jesus, and starts talking about some latter-day understanding of Jesus and being a brother of Lucifer or whatever. It's like, no, you're wrong. You're not going to just come up with a new invention and we've been wrong about Jesus as a church for 2,000 years. We've been wrong about the Trinity. That's ludicrous. There are some things that are old and they're established, and we still bring out those old truths because they are in fact truths and they must be proclaimed. But there are times throughout church history that something new shows up. And once more, just like with Jesus, it's not new in the sense like we're just inventing this and making it up, but it's going back to the scriptures with new eyes and a new understanding as God opens that understanding. And I'll give you a couple examples. You might have heard of this little thing called the Reformation, a guy named Martin Luther. Now, Martin Luther is the key historical figure associated with the start of the Reformation, but he wasn't really the absolute first guy. There were some forerunners before Luther. But the early 1500s, Martin Luther. And what was the issue, the fundamental issue that was new, was that salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone. Luther lived in wild times when the church was saying, look, you write us a big enough check, we'll forgive you of whatever sin you want to commit, right? And that was a big part of Luther, the whole selling of indulgences, if you go and study that history. And so Luther said, this is crazy. This isn't what the truth of God is all about. And so salvation by grace alone, through faith alone. And once more, the emphasis was on the Word of God, which throughout the Middle Ages, or the so-called Dark Ages, had largely been diminished. It was kept in Latin, which at that time no one could read, other than a few scholars. The average person had no idea. And what's worse is when there were efforts to try to get the Word of God into the hands of just regular people in the language that they understood, it was the church that was against it at the time. Look up a guy by the name of John Wycliffe and see the persecutions he endured trying to translate God's Word so that people could read it and understand it. Look up the martyr named William Tyndale, who was actually killed by the organized church because of his commitment to Scripture and translating it into the common language. And so you have something new. Now, here's the irony, though, because I'll give you another example that hits closer to home. And that is with an understanding of how God is going to wrap everything up down here, the end times, as we say. Now, this church, this pastor, and I believe at least the majority of you, because you're here, believe that the world is going to get worse and worse and worse, and one day Jesus is going to return, and he is going to set up his kingdom. We talked about the kingdoms last Sunday. You can review that. The millennial kingdom, and that's going to be a glorious kingdom of peace and prosperity and righteousness. Wonderful. That's what we believe. Now, that belief is commonly mocked, interestingly enough, largely by other, you could say, descendants of the Reformation. Because when we talk about the Protestant Reformation, unless you go background Roman Catholic in the Western traditions and Eastern Orthodox in the East, whether you're talking about Lutherans or Baptists or Methodists or Presbyterians or Calvary Chapel or you name it, you're all talking about the descendants of the Reformation. And yet that view on the end times that I preach and hold to and that many of you believe is often mocked. And you know what the criticism is? It's new, they say. It's only been around, this teaching, for 100-something years or so. So therefore, it can't be right. You see the irony? I'm sure that there were Christians who were challenging Martin Luther and the earlier reformers. Like, this is all new. This can't be right. It's been 1,500 years. But they were right. And we're right. Now, to give you an example, there's another teaching about the end times that has not completely disappeared, but certainly been greatly diminished today. And don't worry about the terms I'm throwing at you. Just get the concept. Remember, we talked about Jesus returning to set up the kingdom. Well, this other view has Jesus returning after the kingdom of peace and prosperity and righteousness, called post-millennial. In other words, afterwards. Now you might say, well, how in the world are we going to have this wonderful kingdom if Jesus hasn't shown up yet? And the answer was, oh, the church is going to establish it. The Christians are going to change the world. And this too was considered a, quote, new teaching. Again, had some little historical markers in the past, but it really gained a lot of steam through the 1700s and then throughout the 1800s and the early 1900s. Why? Well, for starters, because evangelism was just exploding. Christian missionaries were going to China and India and down to Africa and coming to North America, for that matter, right? And on, you saw the evangelism. It's like, yeah, we're going to evangelize the globe. And coupled with that were improvements in situations. Slavery was being outlawed. And, child labor laws were being reformed. And there was all these positive things that were taking place. We were finding cures to diseases. And, of course, the Industrial Revolution, all of a sudden, economic prosperity began to build. And so all this stuff was happening. And you can imagine, if you're a Christian at that time, you're thinking, yeah, this is right on. And they were looking at these things. Now, World War I was a hiccup. Kind of puts a dent into the whole peace and prosperity thing when you have a world war like World War I. But even there, after we got over World War I, it was like, well, we have a League of Nations now. This will never happen again. And we're going to have this peace and prosperity, and the countries are going to work together in the name of Jesus and all this. And it's amazing, though. A few guys named Hitler, Mussolini, and Hirohito, and a second world war, even more devastating than the first. And as I said, that coupled with what we've actually seen take place around the world, things don't seem to be getting better. They don't seem to be getting more prosperous. Yeah, you might have air conditioning, and they didn't have that in the past. You might drive a nicer car than they could back then. People say, well, I'd rather live now than back then. I get it. But in terms of God's standards, when you look at morality and goodness and righteousness, the world's not getting better. It's getting worse. But an interesting thing happened, also connected to World War II. Shortly thereafter, this little nation called Israel was reborn. And all of a sudden, over the decades, Jews have been flocking to live in Israel from all over the world where they had been scattered. Israel been under attack by its enemies and somehow survived, even though they were fighting insurmountable odds. And remember what I said about something new, not just being something created out of the air, but a fresh new look at the scriptures. People began to read the Bible and says, you know what? Why were all those early Christians allegorizing all that Israel stuff? I'm reading my Bible and it says God's going to bring Israel, the Jews, back into the land the second time, and they're never going to be uprooted again. Second time, the first time being after Babylon. The second time now. Never to be uprooted again. It also says Israel is going to be surrounded by enemies. And I look on a map and I see all the nations of the Middle East are Islamic and they're just absolutely committed to Israel's destruction and annihilation. And you begin to look and you realize, wow, I don't have to allegorize this stuff away like the early Christian church did, like Augustine and those guys did. And once more, putting yourself in their shoes. Maybe if you were a Christian living in those days and you saw Rome absolutely level the city of Jerusalem, you saw the Jews be scattered all over the place, maybe you would say, yep, you know, God's brought his judgment on Israel. He's done with the Jews. Let's just go forth with Jesus. Maybe that would have been the conclusion you drew at the time. I believe with all my heart that if all those Christians and theologians from the early days were living now, many of them would be premillennial, just like we are. Again, not because we're looking at the newspaper to determine the truth of God, but we're looking at God's word, and we're looking at his word in the most literal, clear, direct way possible. No need to allegorize. If it says Israel, it means Israel. Jesus says this is what teaching the Bible is all about. It's a treasure, a stewardship. You bring things new and old. Now we've got one more event here before we close as we finish out this chapter. And please remember this, all this teaching about the parables, it's been set in a theme of hostility, of conflict. Remember, they've accused him of being empowered by Satan, and he's teaching the parables to the multitudes not to reveal the truth, but to hide the truth. We talked all about that. So along those lines, verse 53 tells us, it came to pass when Jesus had finished these parables that he departed from there. When he had come to his own country, that'd be Nazareth, of course, he taught them in their synagogue, so that they were astonished. They said, where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? Is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary? And his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas, and his sisters, are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. Now he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. It's a fascinating detail for me because if this happened to Jesus, how can we expect any better? Isn't it true? It's more likely you can have a wonderful conversation about the things of the Lord with a complete stranger waiting at the airport than you can with a close family member or friend who's known you for years, especially if they knew you for many years before you were born again.
Many of us have had that experience, including myself. You know, people that you know from your past, all those people you went to school with or your neighborhood friends and that sort of thing. And do you think they're quick to jump and say, tell me all about your Christian faith, Steve. I want to know more. Are you kidding? We know this guy. Grew up with him. We remember this guy. What's fascinating is we don't see that Jesus argued with him, right? All right, that's it. You guys don't believe? Well, I'm just going to plant my flag here, and I'm not moving until I can talk you into the kingdom. Let's go. He doesn't do that, does he? Because you can't talk anyone into the kingdom. And Jesus didn't try. Why should we try? No, he moved on. We remember that our witness, as we speak the truth in love, our witness is our words, yes, but our witness is also our life, right? And at some point, you got to share the words. But at some point, when those words have been shared and they've been rejected and shut down, your witness becomes your life. Because that person who did know you in the past, if you're walking faithfully to the Lord, at some point they're going to say, I don't know, but he's really changed his life, or she's really changed her life. And that's when you say, no, Jesus changed my life. Like I was telling you before, let's talk some more. And so we witness with our lives. Now, Matthew doesn't include this little detail, but Mark does when he shares this encounter. It says that Jesus marveled because of their unbelief. He just shook his head. I can't believe you guys. He couldn't do many mighty works there. Not because somehow he was disabled, but they didn't come to him, right? We don't want anything to do with this Jesus. I can heal you. I don't believe that stuff. Can you relate? You know someone who's just lost and needs the Lord? And you try to share the love of Jesus, it's free. I mean, he'll change your life. He'll set you on a path. Your purpose, your meaning, you know, to be with your Creator. I don't want anything to do with that. I just want to live in my misery, my sin, my debauchery, my addictions, and all that. And you're like, you just marvel. Marvel because of the unbelief. But at the end of the day, you can just keep praying. Keep praying. Keep living the right way. It's not about giving up on anybody or whatever, but at some point you just move on. Say, I'm going to keep praying for that person, and I'm going to do what Jesus did. I'm just going to move on to the next village. I'm going to go on with my witness to those who might have an ear to hear. It's a great example for us. And again, that's a reminder because we can get so frustrated. And we can blame ourselves. What did I do wrong, Steve? I must have shared it wrong. I said, you didn't do anything wrong. There's no magic formula. Again, it's just all the light. Oh, okay, you said it the right way. And now I'm going to become a Christian. Doesn't work that way, does it? Jesus made it very clear. The reason people don't come to him, the light of the world, is because they want to live in darkness because their deeds are evil. It's just the reality. I don't say that as like being stuck up or, but you just want to live in evil. No, because for a lot of years, I didn't come to him because I wanted to live in evil. Just didn't want anything to do with it. Like the crowd shouted at his crucifixion, we will not have this man to rule over us. That's what a lot of people say today about Jesus. We will not have this man to rule over us. Remember what we said about hell, and you wonder why God created hell. Yes, he created for Satan and the angels, but if you say, I don't want to be ruled by Jesus, I want to be ruled by the devil, well, then you get to spend eternity with the devil. Because those are the only two choices, the only two destinies. I pray that we're all on the path. Narrow path leads to eternal life. Few are going there, relatively few, and yet whoever wills can come. If you know Jesus Christ today, praise the Lord. Keep living for him in these fallen days. Don't be surprised how things get worse and worse. If you don't know the Lord, that's step one. Call on his name and receive his forgiveness. Receive the pardon for all your sins through his blood. His grace is sufficient for you, no matter what you've done. And we all need him, every last one of us. Let's pray.